Welcome to Ted the PI Talks. Terrence McDonough is a private investigator, a forensic interviewer, and public speaker. After 33 years of working as a private investigator on local, national, and international cases, Ted McDonough is bringing his expertise to a larger audience. He has helped families find loved ones, and defense attorneys clear clients in cases ranging from murder to kidnapping and white-collar crime. In this series, Ted will recollect on his experiences and comment on current affairs. Enjoy. So, Terrence, I know you got a lot of calls when the articles came out about Whitey's death, and what were some of the questions people were asking you? When did he disappear for you?
He disappeared in 1995. There was a federal indictment that came down, but it was not. There was a superseding indictment that came down subsequent to the initial indictment. The initial one was about gaming and racketeering and stuff. There were a group of them that got indicted. Whitey, as well as who we represented, his partner, Stevie the Rifleman Fleming. The Rifleman got the same word from John Conley, the disgraced FBI agent, who, by the way, is a friend of mine, but he's doing life and he made some bad choices. But Whitey got the word and he got out of town with a girlfriend of his. Stevie decided, you know, he had to go pay a couple of phone bills or something, and he got picked up the next day. So Whitey was gone. And the FBI were running around with their heads like a chicken with its head cut off. They couldn't find him. But a lot of people felt they didn't want to because the FBI had enabled him, okay? They were happy to have them in their corner because he was a rat that gave up the Italian mafia, including the Angiulos in Boston. So, plus there were so many FBI agents that were no good that were in bed with Whitey. John Conley wasn't the only one. So it's always my belief that they would have rather he never was found.
They were happy he disappeared.
Yeah. So they made all these feeble efforts, my opinion, including sending two FBI agents, like two Cub Scouts, that I won't say what I was going to say. They couldn't find something in Chinatown. They sent them to my house in Ireland, like in February of back then, going into a little remote village where I live, where... to be quite honest, the locals could smell them out. You know, they were asking about Terrence McDonough, and they just pretty much said, I don't know if I can use bad language, but it was pretty much, you're asking some fucking very peculiar fucking questions, lads. And that was the end of that. So he was gone for 16 years. It's a big country. He was prepared, money-wise, false identifications. He was in Louisiana. He was all over the place. You know, there were sightings all over the world.
There was?
Well, because it was a big reward, and they always said, why can't you find him? Well, if I could have, he would have been in the trunk of my car, and I would have been retired with $5 million. But I couldn't find him, but they ended up finding him right down the street from where my daughter lives, coincidentally in Santa Monica. And that was it. And he went to trial, and he got life. He's 87 years old, by the way. No spring chicken.
When he got caught, he was 87.
No, he's 87 now.
Oh.
He got caught in 2013, I think.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Because I was working a case in the Midwest, a missing person case. I was with my son, Brendan. We were in Kansas City, then we were in Kansas, then we went down to the Ozarks on another case. And then I sent Brendan out to L.A. because my daughter was living out there. And then I went to Minnesota, and then I went out to L.A. And while I was there, little did I know that Whitey was living literally right down the street in Santa Monica. But I was asked, would I have been able to identify him? And the answer is no. He's just an old man.
You might not have recognized him if you walked right past him.
No, probably not.
Yeah. So it's not as hard to disappear as they make it seem.
Not if you're prepared.
Yeah.
Money, disguises, false passports, identification. I mean, that's in this country. I mean, you could go to East Jesus, Slovenia, and nobody would ever find you. And there's a lot of places where there's no extradition.
Yeah, even if they do.
And I'm not sure about that with a murder.
Yeah.
But, you know, a lot of people take off.
So another question I'm sure you get asked a lot is about the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum heist. And that's kind of along the same lines of can't find Whitey, they can't find who pulled that off.
Right.
What's your thoughts on that?
It's remarkable, to be honest with you. It was 1990. Only recently, the Boston Globe and actually Kevin Cullen, my friend, they were revisiting it after all these years. And coincidentally, in the 70s and 80s, after I come out of the Marine Corps and put that part of my life behind me, I used to go and just hang around at the Isabella. I'd go in there twice a week and just sit and think. It was beautiful. And at that point, I was on my way to a different place in my life. But, you know, they did, I think, a thorough investigation as to what could have happened. They thought, of course, it was an inside job. And unlike Whitey, who they didn't want to find, they would have loved to have found this because that's the public. And I always thought, because I knew so many criminals, so many wise guys, and that would have been a get-out-of-jail card. you know, that's a big reward. And I knew a few people. And I'll say one of the names, Freddie Pidge. And I went to him. And I said, hey, man, if you know where they are, you're not going to get burnt on this. You're already doing time. You'll probably get out. And he says, and then if I'm part of it, we can get the reward. And I some other people whose names I won't mention. But, you know, why would anybody protect somebody for stealing artwork? So it wasn't like they were afraid of the repercussions.
Or that it was their belief or something that they...
I mean, it's my daughter was just here for Christmas, and she and her husband went in there, and it's a beautiful place. But to think one of the pictures, one of the paintings that I always used to sit and I'd be stoned staring at was Jesus on the Sea of Galilee. It was just fantastic.
Yeah.
And but my belief is they're in some weird collector's basement, maybe in Austria, and I'm throwing out Austria, I could say, you know, Cambodia, maybe New Jersey, but some bizarre, somebody who's in love with them, and will probably never be found. I don't know if they haven't now, 28 years later.
Now, do you think that was, there was a buyer for them before they were stolen?
I don't know. You know, that would have made it a, you know, somebody would have hired whoever did this and said, you know, get those and this is how much I'll give you. I don't know. Art theft is a fascinating field, something I never went into. A friend of mine who I started working as a PI, Charlie Moore, God bless his soul, he was in the Army during Vietnam. He had a plate in his head. He got banged up. I think he did some art work with maybe the FBI or something, but... I don't know. Maybe, hopefully they'll find them someday.
It's been a while.
Probably not. I would love to. Are you kidding me? I'm 72 years old. What a nice retirement check that would be. I couldn't find...
How much is the reward?
I don't know, but more than I have in my savings account.
Hope you enjoyed this episode of Ted the PI Talks. Be sure to like, subscribe, and click on the notification bell to stay informed. You can also visit us at www.tedthepitalks.com.